Flooding can destroy property and have serious effects on health. And it can follow patterns of housing discrimination from almost a century ago. This segment is part of the Checkup, Water and Human Health in a Changing Climate, a project of the Great Lakes News Collaborative. Bridge Detroit environmental reporter Jena Brooker brings us the story.
So my project is mapping Detroit's buried waterways. So I've been out around the city, riding along the routes of the creeks and the streams and the drainage ditches, looking for things that relate to water and trying to understand how to navigate the city from a perspective of water rather than a perspective of concrete or freeways.
So we're further up on Fox Creek now, where the creek daylights. Can you explain what that means?
Joanne Coots is a cartographer. She logged many miles on her two-wheeler, following as closely as she can the trail of numerous buried creeks and streams that flow out of sight under the streets of Detroit.
I tried walking, but the creeks are really, really long. I've ridden about 220 miles so far. So if I tried to walk that, it would like take forever.
I asked Coots how she goes about following these buried creeks if she can't see them.
I use the 1905 USGS map and various other historical maps, which I have downloaded to Gaia, which is a GPS mapping app. And so then I have my phone mounted on the front of my bike and I'm able to see where I am in real time on these historical maps. So I follow the route of the creek on the bike and at the same time I track and it creates a track of where I've been.
All of this tedious hard work is being done for a reason: to produce a user-friendly map of where these buried waterways are located around Detroit.
This is the map so far of all the creeks that I have ridden. And all of these waypoints represent things that I have seen on the creeks that are related to water.
Coates uses symbols and emojis to mark the location of various things like murals and cemeteries, even temporary things like seagulls and Canada geese.
Something that's really important about map making is like it's a snapshot of like an experience. Maps don't have to be things that are always permanent.
Why is it important that people know about buried creeks and where they are?
Scientifically, it may be important from the perspective of ameliorating the impact of flooding.
Although they can't be seen, these waterways are still flowing underground, and the homes and neighborhoods built on top of these ghost streams are more prone to flooding. And it turns out, in Detroit and many other cities, there's a racial component to all of these buried waterways. Jacob Napieralski is a geology and geographic information systems professor at the University of Michigan, Dearborn.
So I did work several years ago where we found out that in Detroit, over 85% of the channels and rivers and streams that existed in 1905 have been removed from the landscape. And then we started to combine that with communities and neighborhoods, and we realized that the way we've sort of segregated communities in Detroit, that also impacts how people experience flood risk. So we've manipulated the landscape, and we've kind of moved neighborhoods and sort of segregated people into these communities. And that was from redlining in the 30s and 40s. And so communities that were redlined and put in communities that were labeled hazardous, they tend to have a much higher flood risk.
Established by the U.S. government during the Great Depression, the Homeowners Loan Corporation was meant to protect homeowners from foreclosure, but it also produced color-coded maps of major cities grading neighborhoods, largely based on race. Wealthy white areas often got A or B ratings, meaning it was safe to loan money there, while areas with more black residents were frequently redlined, given a C or D rating, meaning loans there would be hard to come by.
In these A and B communities, these are the really well-to-do communities, the ones that we had banks and lenders invested in them. They're also the ones that are more protected from really extreme flood risk.
How does that compare to the communities that live in those historically redlined neighborhoods now?
So 96% of the extreme flood risk at the parcel level, they were all in redlined communities.
And many of those high-risk parcels are also on top of buried waterways. This is Jefferson Chalmers, a neighborhood on Detroit's far east side. In the days of redlining, it was given C and D ratings. Long before that, Jefferson Chalmers was a huge marsh called Grand Marais, or Great Marsh, until it was covered over and developed into housing. Some houses back up to canals where residents can anchor their boats. But this water access comes with a price. This neighborhood, built on top of a swamp, is the lowest section of Detroit and has a history of flooding after heavy rainstorms, because deep underground, the water is still flowing. I met with the Reverend Michelle Baylor, co-pastor along with her husband at the Emmanuel Grace AME Church in Jefferson Chalmers.
Welcome to our church.
Thank you.
Baylor vividly recalls the storm of 2021, which dumped 6 inches of rain in the Detroit area. It was the second 500-year storm to hit in a span of just 7 years.
Miss Susan lives right across the way from the church, right? And I remember when it was raining and she called me and she said, "Pastor, the back door is open." And I said, "Well, can you go over and close it?" She was like, "No, not exactly." The water force had literally took the metal door off the hinges.
Baylor took us into the basement of the church, which is used as the fellowship hall. She says during the flood, water came up to the ceiling.
We lost TV, we lost the refrigerator. Everything you see now was replaced. Like the tables, everything had to be replaced. The bathrooms had to be gutted. So all of the bathrooms have been redone. And it took a minute. It took a minute.
And how much do you estimate that cost in you?
It was over $100,000 because our insurance was $100,000.
It was over $100,000 just to repair this basement room. And it wasn't just the church. The entire neighborhood was flooded.
I can't find the right words to say how impactful it is. People are utterly surprised when they go in people's homes and realize that they don't have furnaces back anymore and realize that they still have 3 years of damage from a flood that happened in 2021 because they don't have the resources to clean it.
Right.
But it's their home, so they're living there.
And it's not just the money or the physical damage to homes and property. There's also an emotional impact associated with flooding.
I listened to residents talking about flood anxiety and that when they get a forecast, it's not, oh, here comes the rain and there's excitement. It's, oh, here comes the rain and they go in the basement, they start cleaning up, heart rate goes up. And so there's a lot of research that connects unhealthy conditions, especially mental, to floods. And it's the inner city communities that are most stressed.
Climate change will bring more intense rainfall and make flooding problems worse. And flood risk can affect both the value of a home and the need for flood insurance, which can be expensive. Recently, Zillow added climate risk scores to their listings, and they're not alone. It's smart to think about climate risks, but if flood risk is higher in historically redlined neighborhoods, will these climate risk maps replicate and perpetuate the harms of redlining? Maybe, maybe not. Just across the city limits from Jefferson Chalmers is the city of Grosse Pointe Park, a wealthy suburb that got A and B ratings during redlining. But Grosse Pointe Park was also hit by flooding in 2021. And Zillow's flood risk map reveals the city is almost as flood prone as historically redlined Jefferson Chalmers. There's been a lot more research recently connecting flood risk with vulnerable communities and even redlining in some cities. What made you want to connect this all to Ghost Streams specifically?
I think it was sort of the idea of what we've done in the past influences what we experience now, but can sort of help us understand potential solutions.
One potential solution, daylighting these underground streams by uncovering them. Architect Lars Grebner helped to develop a plan for such daylighting. He contributed to the book titled Mapping Detroit, Land, Community, and Shaping a City.
So I overlaid areas of the city which were vacant and which were in city hand or in hand of the land bank and other areas, and started to dig in to find more and more streams. The idea was really to create a self-sustaining hydrological system, use that as a new way of organizing the city.
Grebner presented his map nearly a decade ago to city planners. He says to implement a plan like this is going to take a lot of initiative, political will, and education of the general public.
This is not an impossible vision. It is actually very practical and will turn the city around to be a much, much better city. And if you think not in political terms, in 4 years or 8 years or 10-year time spans, but in generations, I think one would actually have something to look forward to, you know, a better city.
Daylighting streams may help alleviate flooding in the future by allowing rivers to expand and soak up water during heavy rains. In the meantime, the people who live and work in Jefferson Chalmers do the best they can to cope with a flooding problem that only seems to be getting worse with each passing year.
We don't store anything on the floor anymore.
Okay.
And we have tubs that we put things in so that they won't flood.
I've had people tell me that they remember fishing or learning how to ice skate on a river and the river's no longer there. And if it's manipulated, changed, dried up, if it's removed from the landscape, then part of you goes missing as well. Now it becomes a memory. So I always say the landscape remembers. There's a memory to that landscape. It knows where water's supposed to go. There are people that are going out, walking, biking, because there's a personal connection to those systems.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe, and check out our YouTube channel for even more Great Lakes Now. See you out on the lakes.